in this edition of Art Loft, Transformation of Echo.
The first thing that you see when you enter this exhibit is an enormous pair of hands that are, it looks as though they're parting the wall.
Murals at Boca Raton Museum of Art.
It does an amazing thing when you look at it and you see the reflection in the window behind it, because the next work is the owl held Montaigne's Edge. It's become a stable part of this institution from day one.
Celebrating John Cage.
The name of the festival is appropriate to the essence of this work. It was called Making the Right Choices.
And?
The career of Cuban-born artist Wilfredo Lam was robust, vigorous, and wildly disparate. He traveled the world, inhaled the works of the greats, and steeped himself in the cultures that moved him.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation and...
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida.
Hi, I'm your host, Kaylin James, and this is Art Loft. Welcome to another edition of Art Loft. This week, we're featuring profiles of exhibitions currently on view in South Florida, like Walls of Color, the murals of Hans Hoffman, at the Patricia and Philip Frost Art Museum, Florida International University. Art Week has officially begun, and Art Basel Miami Beach opens this Thursday, December 3rd, and runs through Sunday the 6th. Check out our events calendar at wpbt2.org/artloft to plan your Arts Week schedule. Many of us art lovers will be out enjoying Art Week and Art Basel Miami Beach, so we hope you'll have the photos to show for it. Share your finds with us and fellow arts enthusiasts on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram, and don't forget to tag at ArtLoftSFL. Next, we're off to Young at Art in Davie. Inside the museum, we experience Leah Brown's Transformation of Echo, World of Dreams. Join in as Brown invites us into a dreamscape that tempts you to reflect and explore. Enjoy.
The first thing that you see when you enter this exhibit is an enormous pair of hands that are, it looks as though they're parting the wall. So you're immediately confronted with an option to turn left or right. You can either go through this sort of bedsheet tent, or you can go through a mirrored tunnel that's pretty disorienting, and I think really gives you the sensation of being in a different space, of being in a very vast space, but of having to actually get on your hands and knees and crawl into somewhere that's unexpected, which to me is, I feel like, a way that a dream can be entered, or a different place in a dream can be entered. One space can be crawled into, and it doesn't make any sense how you get there, but suddenly you're somewhere else. Either way that you choose to take, you enter into this dreamscape. I've always been really interested in trying to understand the dreaming mind, the nature of the dreaming mind. That was really my entryway into creating the bulk of the work for this show. Ever since I was little, I've had this connection with my dreams, I've remembered them, and I've been very curious to learn, you know, if I can learn anything more from what I'm dreaming of, the kind of cross dream connections and the characters and the places that are there that, you know, we dismiss in our ordinary lives. But actually, the very act of dreaming is a very interesting process. And it's one that has been really influential to artists throughout history, but really starting in the 1920s with the influence of Freud and the Surrealists. So in some ways, I feel like my work is continuing some of the Surrealist questioning of the resolution of waking and dreaming states, and really trying to delve into to what that is. The sculpture is primarily kind of plaster called hydrocal. Some of it is aqua resin. It's reinforced with burlap and fiberglass and painted. Additionally, surrounding those sculptures are a series of plaster and fabric sculptures that form landscape and figure and animal. It began with sort of the metaphor of bed sheets becoming the fabric of dreams. And so I was draping plaster figures and people that I was casting, and the deer and the trees. And it was almost like having them be wrapped in bed sheets. But then also the texture of it, I felt, began to take on the texture of bark and of fur, and start to do really interesting things where it blended together and become almost like a Grecian garb that could both reveal and conceal what was beneath it. I've been working with Young at Art for the past couple of years in different capacities. Mindy Schrago was actually at my thesis review for finishing up my graduate requirements through the University of Miami in their sculpture department. She came to my final thesis defense and acted as an outside member, and I think gained more of a familiarity with my artwork that way. Also, Zach Speckler with Blanc, the Bedlam Lorenz Assembly, they had reached out to me and asked if I would be interested in doing an exhibition in some capacity. And of course, I jumped at the opportunity. The Young at Art Museum is a fantastic venue. It's not just for kids. I have seen more wonderful art installations here that are accessible to both children and adults than at basically any other venue in South Florida.
For more on Leah Brown, visit leahbrownart.com. Transformation of Echo is open through January 3rd. For more info, visit youngatartmuseum.org. Up next on Art Loft.
The name of the festival is appropriate to the essence of this work. It was called Making the Right Choices.
Continuing north, we visit the Boca Raton Museum of Art in Palm Beach County. There, the museum's executive director, Irvin Lipman, introduces us to select murals in their permanent collection. Take a look.
I'm Irvin Lipman, the executive director of the Boca Raton Museum of Art. If you're looking to be photographed or to do a selfie at the museum, you want to stand in front of the Jose Alvarez mural. Jose is very interested in the mystical, in the shamans, and the journey that one can take through the universe. And so if you stand in front of that and allow your eye to sort of wander in and around the colors and the shapes, you realize it becomes sort of a beautiful garden of fantastical spaces. And his idea is that you're taking a journey. And in that way, the work is really a metaphor for your whole visit to the museum. It's sort of beautiful, it's breathless, and hopefully, at least according to Jose, it has a healing process. It makes you feel good. Well, the cube that you see as you enter the museum is called Marty's Cube. It's named for Marty Margulies from Miami. Many people will remember this cube when it was on the campus of FIU in Miami. And we were told that before an exam on FIU campus, students would come and push it to wish themselves good luck on the exam. Already, it has become of great success here at the entryway, and you find kids, adults, people of all ages, pushing it, spinning it around, and it becomes very animated, and that's what the artist Tony Rosenthal wanted to do. It looks, because it is a cube, very much like a city plan, and within that cube, you find alleyways and stairs and various shapes, but when it really becomes exciting is when you push it. And that then is the interaction of man, woman within their city space. It does an amazing thing when you look at it and you see the reflection in the window behind it, because the next work is the Al Held Montaigne's Edge. It's become a stable part of this institution from day one. And it's a remarkable work. It's called Montaigne's Edge. So it makes a reference to the great Renaissance artist, Montaigne, who was famous for creating these perspectives. There are all these lines that come together, but it's not claustrophobic. And certainly, it's so big that it does fill your peripheral vision. It sort of makes you sort of float inside that space. Something that might look breathless allows you to breathe, allows you to go through the space and enjoy it.
For more info about the exhibitions at the Boca Raton Museum of Art, visit bocamuseum.org. Up next on Art Loft.
The career of Cuban-born artist Wilfredo Lam was robust, vigorous, and wildly disparate. He traveled the world and hailed the works of the greats and steeped himself in the cultures that moved him.
Now we head to the week's hub of activity, Miami Beach. At the New World Symphony, Associate Dean for Chamber Music, Michael Linville, introduces us to the John Cage Video Archive and the festivals produced to honor Cage's work. Enjoy.
The New World Symphony is an orchestral academy. We bring players from all over the world. They come to us for three-year fellowships. Lots of experimentation goes on at the New World Symphony, and the Cage Festival fits right into that.
My name is John Cage. I'm from Stony Point, New York.
John Cage was an important composer from the 20th century who first introduced the idea of aleatoric music, in other words, music that has chance as an element in its creation, so he leaves choices up to the musicians about what they want to play and when and how.
John Cage was a maverick. He was an American maverick, and he began to explore the business of letting musicians, giving musicians a framework from which they would make choices. And the name of the festival is appropriate to the essence of this work. It was called Making the Right Choices.
John Cage broke away from the traditional way of notating music with five lines and four spaces and started to use other symbols to be interpreted by the musicians.
And he created a visual language that was kind of like hieroglyphs, indicators of where he wanted musicians to go with their imaginations, but not so specific in terms of pitch or duration or timbre or texture. That was up to the player.
So it could be a series of squiggles, it could be little blocks or dots on a page that were left up to the players to decide what pitches they wanted to play or what dynamic, how loud or how soft, or even where on their instruments they wanted to play.
He kept inviting players to be themselves, to be more themselves than they might otherwise be if they were playing a Mozart symphony.
For these performances, we had musicians of a traditional symphony orchestra, so all of the instruments that you would imagine in a modern symphony, plus instruments that are not really instrument. There was a performance art piece that was done by one of our violists, Tony Parse, called Water Walk, where all of these household devices were set up near a piano with a giant bathtub in the middle. And he had the task of running through this cycle of all of these different devices. Almost every piece was treated in some way outside of just the sonic performance of the piece. For one piece, there was a giant hot air balloon that was suspended over the main orchestra and images were projected onto it. There were other streams of sound that came through. Everything was enriched by lighting elements, video, sometimes audio elements that all were superimposed on John's music.
And you really are able to explore Cage's imagination, Cage's thought process, and Cage's intention as far as music goes. So it's a great combination. The secret sauce, the trump card, is Michael Tilson Thomas, our founding artistic director. He knew Cage. He played Cage's music in conversation with John Cage. So he understood, as very few people can understand, the aesthetic, the approach, the essence of the music, and that was then translated. He translated that to our fellows as they prepared for the performances.
We have this evolution that comes straight down from the composer to the musicians who are now being trained at the New World Symphony, and I think there's a tremendous benefit that they get from having that experience. To share this with the public, the only way that we could make it accessible would be to launch a website that included archival footage of the performances and then also behind the scenes video of the artists talking about the works that they were preparing.
By capturing the performances and the backstory, the conversations, the rehearsals that went into the preparation of those performances, what we were able to do was give future generations a chance to get deep inside this music.
I hope that people who look at the website can actually get a sense of who John Cage was and how important his contribution to the evolution of music, especially in this country, was.
I'm not predicting that John Cage will become universal. I'm not prepared to do that. But I am prepared to say that our fellows must dig deep. They must find their way into these languages.
He is probably the most controversial figure in the musical world today, and when you hear his performance, if you will forgive me, you will understand why.
He actually contributed a great amount to our musical culture, and also had this very deep, sensitive, unique voice that no one else has ever been able to capture since him.
Some of them are going to laugh. Is that all right?
Of course. I consider laughter preferable to tears.
I'm with you, boy. All right, let's see this instrument.
You can delve into the archive now by visiting nws.edu/John Cage. And for more on New World Symphony, visit nws.edu. Next week on Art Loft.
And it all runs like clockwork. Until one week each summer,
city completely changes. The atmosphere completely switches into another mode.
Simply put, it's staggering. From beginning to end, the career of Cuban-born artist Wilfredo Lam was robust, vigorous, and wildly disparate. He traveled the world and hailed the works of the greats and steeped himself in the cultures that moved him.
He's difficult to categorize. He's a complex man.
With an equally complex beginning, says curator Elizabeth Goitsueda, who spent 10 years assembling this Lam retrospective at Boston College's McMullen Museum of Art. Born in 1902, Lam immediately had four continents in his blood.
I don't think he had any choice but to remain open, as in African, Spanish, Chinese man born in the Caribbean. His godmother was a Santera priestess. His mother was a devout Roman Catholic. That was his normalcy. And I think that he kind of had a quest and a hunger for that and continued to explore that.
Starting in Spain, where he studied at the Prado and was spellbound by the Surrealists.
I don't think he had an agenda per se. I think he became involved emotionally and intellectually with different movements, and from that emotion he painted.
The Spanish Civil War forced Lam to Paris in the 1930s, putting him in close proximity to the artist he held above all others.
In an interview he says, seeing Picasso's work was much like a pervasion of the spirit. It just kind of infused him with inspiration.
By the late 1930s, Lam had what he'd yearned for, a letter of introduction to Picasso.
And Picasso puts his arm around him and says, "You remind of me of somebody I knew long ago, me." So, you know, it's classic, quintessential Picasso. But I think that endorsement gave Lam the ability and the power to continue to explore these motifs that he was very interested in exploring. And as a black man, it gave him more credibility even than Picasso.
Did he struggle with race and his own identity?
Before 1941, he never experienced racism, either in Spain or France. It was upon his return to Cuba that he became very familiar with the negritude movement and a champion, if you will, of those causes to raise the black person to a level of dignity that all men have.
It was World War II which had forced Lam back to Cuba and then on to New York, where he took up with the abstract expressionists. He was, Goizueta says, a sponge.
What is so extraordinary about his work is he doesn't get stagnated in one particular period, but yet he's always compelled to move forward and to look at the next period.
For the next 40 years, until his death in 1982, Lam continued to push himself, to explore. But as much as he thirsted for artist circles, more than anything, Lam identified with poets.
He says that himself, he would have liked to have been a poet. But he says, "I think painting can be just as eloquent. It's more as if you would approach poetry with a very open mind and to try to absorb what he is trying to tell the viewer."
Perhaps for his insatiable quest for the new, Lam has long been beyond the full grasp of critics. But thanks to the McMullen Show and upcoming European ones, that is all about to change.
There is a shift. Lam has in the past been maybe pigeonholed as a surrealist or as a Latin Americanist, but I think now he is truly staking his claim as one of the great modernists of the 20th century.
As you see here.
Don't miss Walls of Color, the murals of Hans Hoffmann at the Patricia and Philip Frost Art Museum, Florida International University, on view through January 3rd. Thanks so much for joining us this week. Let Art Loft inspire your creativity every day. Visit WPBT2.org/ArtLoft to watch past episodes and get social with us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at ArtLoftSFL. I'm Kaylin James reminding you to stay creative. Happy Art Basel, Miami Beach. Bye. Serena Panche, look over there. Hear from one of their contributing artists. I messed it up at the end. Dang it. South Florida, like Walls of Color. But I did something. I shouldn't turn just the hands, not the head, right? Leia, 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 Leia. I did it. Now we head to the week's hub of activity. Please, please, may I have one title? No, I won't smile for you. Yeah. Wait, what, huh? Some who? Leg muscles? To the gun show? I already did that part. Oh, darn. One, two.
turtle.
Dang it. It's all your fault. You did it. That's a wrap, everybody.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation and...
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida.